With that, Congressman Jamie Raskin.
Hello, you beautiful Maricopa County Democrats. What a pleasure to be here in Phoenix. We're surrounded by a lot of very cool people, including the next majority leader of the state Senate, Mitzi F. I know there's some other distinguished people in our presence. And Marty, because I packed and I forgot it was going to be St. Patty's Day, so Marty, our host, did give me a green handkerchief. Good luck along the way. Wow, I'm thrilled, really, to be with you guys. This is a beautiful. Thank you for opening up your beautiful house for us. With a great history already and even a greater future ahead, this house has some superb political feng shui. I can feel it. And it had the feel of victory to me. Thank you for coming. Did you guys just come to hear me speak?
Yes.
I'm going to speak. Is that right?
Yeah.
I just for like an hour and 45 minutes. Let's see. All right. Well, before I start, I do want to salute Denise and Marty and the great activists who are turning Arizona into a true blue state. And I know Maricopa is the beating heart of the big blue wave in 2024.
Yeah.
And so we're looking to you, and I traveled here from Maryland to be with you and to meet the great Arizona Democrats who are here in their county. So we are all here as true blue Democrats, but I wanted to start on a bipartisan note and invoke our last great Republican president, Abraham Lincoln. Spoke of government of the people, by the people, and for the people. And that's been the tantalizing, beautiful ideal of America from the beginning. We didn't start off that way. We started as a slave republic of white male property owners over the age of 21. But when Jefferson inscribed those words into the Declaration of Independence, he set a process into motion whereby successive generations of Democratic patriots would fight for a more perfect union. And we've gotten much, much closer over the centuries. If you read the Constitution the way I do, of the 17 amendments we've added to the original Bill of Rights, the vast majority of them are democratizing amendments to deepen and expand suffrage rights, voting rights, to expand the meaning of democracy. The 13th Amendment abolished slavery. The 14th Amendment gave us equal protection and due process. The 15th Amendment banned race discrimination in voting. The 17th Amendment shifted the mode of election of the U.S. senators from the legislatures to the people. The 19th Amendment doubled the franchise by giving women the right to vote. The 23rd Amendment gave people in Washington the right to vote, at least for president of the United States. The 24th Amendment banned poll taxes as a blockade to political participation. And the 26th Amendment lowered the voting age to 18. The whole trajectory of American constitutional, historical, and political development has been towards making a greater union, a more perfect union, and a stronger democracy. Sometimes my colleagues will get up on the floor of the House and let's say, Raskin keeps talking about democracy. We're not a democracy, we're a republic. And they think they really got me on that one, you know? A republic is a representative democracy. That's all a republic is. It's a representative democracy because we can't fit 300 million people in a school board meeting or in the House of Representatives. That's what a representative democracy is. If we represent people to go and reincarnate the public opinion, the values and the priorities of the public. But those of us who aspire and attain to public office are nothing but the servants of the people. And the moment that we think we're kings or queens or dictators or czars, that's the moment to eject, reject, impeach, convict, and start all over again. Because we don't need kings and queens in in America. The people of the public office are nothing but the servants of the people and the common good. That's what we are. But I'm here to tell you, this is my my 18th state that I've come out to. Because I'm throwing everything into this election.
Awesome.
Have you ever thought of donating a year of your life to democracy and freedom? This is the year to do it, okay? Don't wait until 2037 or something like that. 2024 is the year. But I got to tell you, having been to 18 states now, I am proud to be a Democrat.
Yeah.
I am proud to be a Democrat because I meet people like the people at this amazing event everywhere I go. There are people, they're not in it for the money. They're not in it for foreign government emoluments. They're not in it for $2 billion from Saudi Arabia.
No.
They're in it for the future of the United States of America. That's the Democratic Party.
That's a billion in hurtful.
No.
And I'm proud of the record that President Biden has assembled in his first of two terms in office, okay? I sat there for 4 years under Donald Trump. We had infrastructure week. We had infrastructure month. We had infrastructure day. We just never had an infrastructure bill. And Joe Biden got it in the first week. He said it's an infrastructure bill. We passed it, a $1.5 trillion investment in the roads, the highways, the bridges, the ports, the airports, rail, trail, rural broadband, rapid internet for every American. The Democrats did that.
Yeah.
We did that. The Chips and Science Act.
Yeah.
Revitalize the semiconductor industry in America to jumpstart it.
Right here
in Arizona. Inflation Reduction Act.
Yeah.
We got the lowest inflation rate of the industrialized world, the lowest inflation rate of the, I cannot ever remember if it's the G7 or G8. Did we kick Russia out yet? Of the G7. We've got the lowest inflation rate. We've got the best employment rate. Lower than 4% unemployment for 29 straight months. The small business sector is roaring. We've left behind the unemployment and the desolation that Donald Trump left us with COVID-19 and his lethal recklessness in telling people to go ahead and inject bleach or take hydroxychloroquine. Reason governs again in America with President Biden. And when you keep clapping for President Biden's State of the Union address, okay?
Yeah.
How about that? And it's got to be the greatest State of the Union address of our lifetime.
Yeah.
Amazing.
Yes.
And, you know, the thing I got to confess to you, fellow Democrats, that I love the most about it, after Donald Trump has trashed every constitutional principle and ideal, every federal law governing the behavior of federal office holders, after he's violated every rule of decorum and politeness we have in America, I got to see Joe Biden violate one taboo that I'm really glad he violated. He stared them in the face and he told the truth to the Supreme Court. He stared them in the face. When they overthrew more than a half century of precedent to destroy Roe versus Wade, which was what Donald Trump sent them to do, and which Donald Trump is running around the country bragging about having done. When they did that, they said along the way, well, we can leave it up to the states. Women are not without political or electoral power. That was the line Joe Biden quoted to them, and he said, you're about to see how much political and electoral power women have in America. I'm proud of Joe Biden. Every day I'm proud of Joe Biden, an old-fashioned public servant who puts the people first. Right? He's not in it as a money-making operation for his family and for his friends. He's in it for the common good. Those are two radically contrasting public philosophies. The Democratic Party says government must be an instrument for the good of all. And Donald Trump says he's going to take over the government and make it a money-making operation. He took millions of dollars in illegal foreign government emoluments from Saudi Arabia, from China, from Indonesia, from governments all over the world. and we've documented it. Check out the report the Oversight Committee Democrats put out called White House for Sale. There's no question about it. And that was just what they did during office, and just a fraction of it, because we only got four of his more than 500 companies, the records for that, before Chairman Comer shut it down. And we only got 20 countries out of 175 countries in the world. And we only did what took place while he was president. Jared Kushner brought back a cool $2 billion from Saudi Arabia for a company he created the day after the administration ended, okay? Donald Trump had, and Donald Trump has, a staph infection, okay? The whole administration was devoted to corruption and to Donald Trump. We know who he is. The Democrats know who he is. The Republicans, the few that are still with them, the MAGA Republicans, they know who he is. The independents know who he is. The question in this election is, who are we? Who are we going to be? Are we going to put up with that model of corruption and authoritarianism? Or are we going to fight for the expansion of democracy and freedom the way our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents did? That's the choice for us. It gives me no joy to say that the Republican Party is gone. I've got the bust of one president in my office, Abraham Lincoln, which I inherited from my grandfather, who loved Lincoln the way I loved Lincoln. But Lincoln's party was a party of freedom. It was a party of union. It was an anti-know-nothing, anti-conspiracy theory, pro-reason, pro-science party. They've taken Lincoln's party, they've reduced it to an authoritarian cult of personality, propaganda, disinformation, and conspiracy theory. And just like the Republican Party of Abraham Lincoln replaced the Whigs, somebody should come along and replace the Republican Party because it's gone under Donald Trump. It's gone. And every day I hear from Republicans who say we can't take it anymore. I hear from independents who say I'm coming over to the Democratic Party. It is upon us and the people here today in the tents to create a big tent for the Democratic Party. Everybody who wants to stand up for democracy, like my friend Liz Cheney, like Adam Kinzinger, like Mitt Romney, we say, come on over to the Democratic Party. Come on over. You know, sometimes my colleagues across the aisle, they can't correctly pronounce the name of our party in its adjectival form. They'll say, you know, that that Democrat congresswoman with their Democrat bill and their Democrat amendment. And for 7 years, I've gotten up and I've gently reminded them, no, Democrat's the noun, okay? Democratic is the adjective. If you're gonna sneer at us, you gotta say the Democratic bill, the Democratic amendment. So now they know it gets on my nerves. So they all get up and they start doing it. Matt Gaetz and Johnson and Lauren Boebert and one day I was on the floor with Lauren Boebert, and she did it, and I got up, and I gently reminded her, about the difference between the noun and the adjective and everything, and so they kept doing it, and I lost my temper. I try not to lose my temper. You know who I work with, okay? And I said, you know, you guys have this self-imposed political speech impediment, and it's contagious. It's coming all over my side. Now when I try to say the name of your party, it just comes out the Banana Republican Party. Banana Republican Congress. Banana Republican bill. And so I went home and I told my wife, because she knows this bugs me, and I said, I finally got them back. I did it, and I told her what I'd done, and she said, that was an extremely immature response. So I started feeling bad. But I was reading a great book about a great Democrat. It's called Traitor to His Class by H.W. Brand, who's an historian at UT. It's about Franklin D. Roosevelt. I don't know if you guys have read this book, but amazing book about Roosevelt. And I learned something special in there, which is it's got Roosevelt's speeches. And Roosevelt did not call our party the Democratic Party, much less the Democrat Party. He called our party, at least this is how the historians transcribe it, with a capital D, the democracy. The democracy. So he would say, well, the economic royalists and the plutocrats say you invest in the very wealthiest people in society, and some of the wealth will just dribble down magically on everybody else. But the democracy says you invest in the great American working middle class. We will all rise and prosper together. That's the doctrine of the democracy. And so now, when they can't pronounce the name of our party, I tell them just do what FDR and Eleanor Roosevelt did. Just call us the democracy. You know, because that's what we are today. Think about it. Who stands up for everybody's right to vote, even if they're not going to vote for us? We got all these great Democratic organizers here, precinct officials, the election managers, people who are fighting for Democrats to win. Have you ever been to one meeting of Democrats where somebody got up to say, how are we going to disenfranchise the Republicans?
No.
How are we going to repress the vote around that country club or something like that? It doesn't happen, because the Democratic Party is the party of democracy. We stand up for the results of free and fair elections, even when they don't go our way. But here's what the political scientists tell us. These are some of the critical hallmarks of a fascist or an authoritarian political party. Number one, they refuse to stand by the outcome of democratic elections that don't go their way.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, they refuse to disavow or they openly embrace political violence as an instrument for obtaining political power and maintaining it. Mm-hmm. Three, they're organized around a cult of personality, around a charismatic or allegedly charismatic politician whose word is elevated above the rule of law and the Constitution, and who engages in ceaseless scapegoating of minorities, immigrants, LGBTQ. Those are the hallmarks of a fascist political party. They got mad at our friend Joe Biden when he said that there are semi-fascist currents running in the Republican Party. But I'm sorry, if the shoe semi-fits, you semi-wear it. And President Biden knew what he was talking about. Our job is not just to defend democracy, because democracy is never standing still. It's to make democracy move forward, right? Tocqueville said in Democracy in America, he observed that democracy in our country is either shrinking and shriveling away, or it's growing and expanding. We've got to get back on the growth track in America. And that's a tough job, because we got to play defense and offense at the same time. The Democrats are up for it. It's 2024. How about it's time for us to start electing the President of the United States the way we elect governors, mayors, representatives, senators, whoever gets the most votes.
Yes.
How about that?
Please.
The Electoral College has given us five popular vote losers in our history. Twice in this century alone. In 2000 with George W. Bush.
Yep.
In 2016 with Donald Trump. It marginalizes the vast majority of Americans who are in safe red states or safe blue states. I know Arizona is a swing state. It's going blue.
Yeah.
But it's a swing state. But how about we have a national election where every vote counts and every vote counts equally, no matter where you are. And we count all the votes.
Yeah.
How about that? We don't have counterfeit electors. How about that? I know you guys know something about counterfeit electors here. I think they invented counterfeit electors.
Right here.
I know what you guys are up against. It's hard to be a Democrat in Arizona. You got to know why you're a Democrat in Arizona and what you're fighting for. We got to keep democracy moving forward. We really do, in a lot of ways. We got 713,000 tax-paying, draftable American citizens who live in Washington, D.C., the only residents of a national capital on planet Earth who are not represented in their own Congress. It's time for D.C. statehood.
Yep.
It's time for statehood to be in Washington. We got 3.5 million American citizens in Puerto Rico who are disenfranchised in Congress and for president. It's time for Puerto Rican statehood in America. It's time for us to move democracy forward. And you know, what is democracy about when you think about it? Because democracy is not the ultimate value, right? We're fighting for freedom.
Yeah.
Look what their gerrymandered Supreme Court has done. You know, what one of my constituents, Merrick Garland, was nominated to the Supreme Court by President Obama in February of 2016. And Mitch McConnell, in his wisdom, said, no, 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 that's 10 months before the election. We couldn't get it done before that. And it wouldn't be fair to actually nominate and confirm a Supreme Court justice in the last year of the president's term. Sure. We want to leave it to the people. Of course, the people had decided when we elected Barack Obama president. But they blocked it, right? Yeah. Then, in 2020, in October, when Ruth Bader Ginsburg, may she rest in peace, when she died 2 months before the election, early voting had started in a whole bunch of states. Mitch McConnell laughed it off. He said it was a big joke, and they were going to ram it through and put through Mrs. Waterford or whatever her name is. And they jammed that through. And look what they've done. They've dismantled women's right to choose. They're attacking voting rights. Just like they dismantled the Voting Rights Act in Shelby County versus Holder. So we've got to fight to defend our democracy. The Supreme Court is not going to save us. I take it that's not news to you guys. Yeah. The Supreme Court is not going to save us. But we've got to fight to defend democracy at every level. The federal level and the state level and the local level in every state in the union. That's our job. Sometimes my Republican colleagues will say to me, you know, Raskin, you're not such a bad guy. The problem with you is you're a liberal. I said, you're damn right I'm a liberal. Yeah. The heart of that word is liberty. Oh. And I'm a progressive because the heart of that word is progress. Yeah. If we're not making progress, what are we doing in politics? But my favorite thing to call myself absolutely today is a conservative. You know why? I want to conserve the land, the air, the water, the climate system, Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, the Affordable Care Act, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, the National Labor Relations Act, the Fair Labor Standards Act, everything that their party of authoritarians and nihilists wants to destroy is everything that we're going to conserve. The Democrats are the party of democracy, of the liberals, the progressives, and the conservatives today. That's who we are.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The Democratic Party. That's who we are. And before somebody asked me the question, the Biden administration is doing a great job, but nobody's messaging right. And how come you're not messaging? Because wherever I go, everybody's talking about messaging. So I brought you a message, all right? All the way from Maryland, I brought you a message. And it's from my Democracy Summer program. I spend no money, no campaign money on polls, TV, radio, none of that stuff. I put it into a school for young people called Democracy Summer for high school and college kids across America. We're now in every state, including in Arizona. Please sign the young people up here to join Democracy Summer. We need them. I know Democracy Summer in Arizona means they'll basically be inside, not outside. But whether they're on the phones or on the internet or at the doors, we need them. We need them. But anyway, what I tell them is this. Everything that you need to know about voting is everything that you need to know about driving. If you want to go forward, you put it in D.
Yes.
If you want to go backwards, you put it in R.
Yeah.
That's all you need to know. I'm going to leave you with the words of two great democracy patriots I've kept close to my heart through this period of turbulence in our national life. And one is the great Frederick Douglass, who was born like 45 minutes away from my house at the Wye River Plantation into slavery. And he escaped from slavery to become a great freedom fighter through the Civil War, through Reconstruction. And Douglass said, if there's no struggle, there's no progress. The struggle may be moral, it may be physical, it may be moral and physical, but there must be struggle. Power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has, and it never will. There's a message to you from Frederick Douglass and the people of Maryland. And I'll leave you finally with the words of the great Tom Paine, who my son Tommy was named after. And Paine got here in 1774, two years before the Revolution, and he fell in love with the promise of America. He said, if this land lives up to its ideals, it will become an asylum to humanity. not an insane asylum, mind you.
That's Congress.
A place of refuge for people fleeing from religious and political and economic oppression from all over the world.
Yeah.
And he wrote Common Sense, the pamphlet that ignited the revolution. Mm-hmm. And by common sense, he meant the sense that you can have, even if you didn't go to the Princeton Theological Seminary or whatever, the sense we have in common when we're willing to reason together, speak and listen together, without propaganda and conspiracy theory and nonsense, when we're willing to use our common sense. But anyway, 1776, it was a tough year. And remember, for the vast majority of human history, to that day, and even to this day, people have lived under the kings and the queens and the dictators and the czars. People like Vladimir Putin and Viktor Orban, who just had a slumber party over in Mar-a-Lago, and Donald Trump. That's been the fate of most humanity. Democracy is the exception, right? Democracy is the exception. And so everybody's running around saying, well, what's the message and who's the messenger and all that stuff. And so Paine wanted to give people some hope, to embolden people. And he wrote this pamphlet called The Crisis. And I just want to quote a little passage for you. I'm updating the language pursuant to instructions from Nancy Pelosi. Tom Paine was a feminist, an early feminist, and that he was. He was a suffragette, even back in the 1700s. But anyway, he wrote these lines. He said, "These are the times that try men and women's souls. The summer soldier and the sunshine patriot will shrink at this moment from the service of their cause and their country. But everyone that stands with us now will win the love and the favor and the affection of every man and every woman for all time. Tyranny, like hell, is not easily conquered, but we have this saving consolation. The more difficult the struggle, the more glorious in the end will be our victory. Let's make that victory ours in 2024, Arizona Democrats."
Yeah.
Thank you. Hang in with President Biden all the way through November. Thank you.